terms of those points, quite frankly, the difference between a head of paid service and chief executive is largely semantic. So those authorities of this size and shape that have a head of paid service rather than a chief executive, I know one in particular that recently changed from one to the other, the terms and conditions are exactly the same, and the new head of paid service is paid exactly the same as the previous chief executive. So it is, by and large, a matter of semantics.
So the difference is only in name.
So that's the first point. But as you said, that's perhaps a wider discussion that can take place with HR going forward. In terms of returning officer in the RO, that role within local authorities is held almost exclusively by the chief executive or by myself, so I'm not going to comment further on that for fairly obvious reasons. And in terms of the discussion with Mr. Sator, clearly those have been on the basis of the council has a common pay scale and pay grade for the chief executive. If you were to seek to offer this to him on different terms and conditions than the existing gradings for chief executive, then that would be a matter to take outside of this room. Would you agree to agree or not?
Thank you. Jeff?
Yes. Except I think the points that Leslie has made are good ones. In your imagination, as you currently envisage it, Mr. McCall was saying that the head of paid service would be the same as the chief executive. That might not be how we envisage it. All of the people envisage it. So I think a wider discussion. Because let's be honest, there has been a, in terms of the debates with the public and the discussions with the public conversations, there is a sense that do we need so many highly paid chief officers and so on and so forth. So I think what this is alluding to, and the decision with regards, as Leslie points out, our view that Paul Sator should have, you know, 12 months subject to performance appraisal and so on, allows for that discussion to take place. I mean, what do we want the future shape of officer team to be? Do we think it's too many? Do we think it's too many? What are the lines of responsibility? All those things. And I have a view that a head of paid service would be completely different from the head of personnel, if you like, but with those accountabilities, responsibilities attached. So I do think there is merit in giving ourselves some time in order to review those particular issues and to see if there is a different way of imagining councils that might well actually correlate and align with the work that's going on with regards to what should the political structure of the council be, along with what should the officer structure be. The other thing, and again this has been a question of discussion and conversation with the public, is the level of remuneration. There is no doubt, and we have been very clear all the way along in terms of salaries, that we think public the officer salaries are too high. I personally do not believe that any chief officer should be getting a salary beyond that which the Prime Minister of this country gets, which is not insignificant, but you know, even despite all those leaflets you see, I still think it's more difficult to run the country than it is to run Wirral. So I still think that
the value of the Prime Minister has been calculated as 10 million. So
well,
as an income, yeah, we would be delighted to see that.
But yeah, and of course her salary, which is a matter of the record, is only 53,000. So we have an argument, or am I? So certainly in terms of the public record, her salary is 153, including her MP's salary. So remember, Chair, at the last meeting, I tried to get us in a position where we had a multiplier. So no chief officer would get more than a multiplication of the lowest paid member of the office. Do you remember that conversation? And there was going to be a review. Now, this has happened before that review has taken place. So given that we're doing this on an interim basis for 12 months or up to 12 months, I think it's perfectly reasonable for us to say to Paul, and I can give a testimony to Paul as an excellent public servant, a great officer, and someone who I think will do. We're all proud in those terms, in terms of any PMV took over. But I think we can still go to Paul and say, we think you're as valuable as the Prime Minister of this country, current and future. And actually, we would like you to do the job, but this is the salary that we look. These are the terms and conditions, and this is the salary we want. I think all of that is wholly consistent. And from my understanding of the Constitution, it's perfectly within the remit of this committee to make those decisions.
Okay. Well, let me warn you that I have seven more names people put their hands up and no eight. So we'll start off with Anita.
Thank you, Chair. Over the last night at the Standards Committee, we started what will be a 9-month process to review council governance. I feel we can't just jump in feet first to a completely new leadership structure without fully evaluating it. So I feel that we should go down the same sort of route of evaluation and give it the same credence. I don't think we should make decisions on a whim.
Nikki.
I was just simply going to ask that there was these points in terms of the time for 12 months. So it was an estimate, and I think it's made clear in the report that it's until such times that you have met all of the other terms that can be made. And 12 months does give us time to do exactly as we've got to go, as is outlined in the recommendation 3, and we do intend to do that. And I think we all agree that there are many ways in which we could consider the leadership structure of the organisation going forward, and we do have some of the considerations and
conversations.
Thank you, Jay. I don't think it's reasonable to ask Paul's at all to take the acting chief exec role at anything less than the norm that would be expected across the country. And I think, you know, we will be in competition when, for a really good chief exec, when that comes up. And if we're not paying the same rate of salary as other places, we've got no chance of getting anybody of quality. And, you know, nobody's going to come to the Wirral for thousands less than they can get somewhere else. So I think you pay for what you get, really. It's about peanuts and monkeys, as far as I'm concerned.
Phil
I'm trying to recall a conversation I had with an officer to my right yesterday about planning. I don't disclose that because an officer can give advice. First headache is we live in this strange society where the people running company chains of schools getting £200,000 a year, which is, and more, which is quite astonishing and quite offensive when schools are in some financial trouble. The second thing that crossed my mind is that bearing in mind what the regional weekly pay appears to be for most members of the public around Harborough, the contrast between what senior officers get and what normal, I would say, general people in our community get is probably five times what we might expect. So our citizens are naturally anxious to know what we actually get from this. I think the third thing is the question of report, and if we're looking at the wording of section 3, I'll come on to that, but I was given a figure at which point Mr. Cllr might be taking on, because he would come in at a certain grade level, which is not what the chief executive gets now. But I also have looked up, that's not recently, the council has translated and certainly revised by the week. And I think in that document there was an exception if the council thought the market was rate was such that there was a huge differential, you couldn't get somebody who'd go in line with the market rate. But as I read the report, as I think about it, we're in a situation where we're not currently going out to market, and therefore the differential of salary between the officer that we've been thinking of appointing at the point and the staff down at the lowest levels ought to reflect what's in our annual pay policy statement rather than take account of the market. I'm happy if somebody look up the annual pay policy statement that the council approved some months ago, remind me of its terms, but I think it's in it.
I don't think it is, because I asked for it to be included and it was kind of
hold on.
Stopped.
Janette was the next speaker. Janette?
Thank you, Chair. I was just interested in how we compare sort of metropolitan areas or similar size or the council. It's a bit odd that we don't want to automatically remunerate as much as expected. From as a lay person, I would have been the first in line to criticise as well. After being on the council for 7 years and seeing the level of responsibility workload that Archibald I has, I feel that comparison with the Prime Minister is possibly unfortunate at this given time. I know my things have done a better job in the next few years. I would be interested though to see how you compare, how that pay does compare, whether or not we're in that line in terms of what we pay currently, whether it's fair to expect all to step in to do that role.
Tony may be able to answer two of the points raised, one of which is how does Will compare, second being actually what is the terms and conditions as already agreed and set out in the Council's pay policy for Chief Executive, and then thirdly I will just remind members that you're going to an office of the Council and say would you step up, and the assumption is that that is on the agreed terms and conditions for the Chief Executive of the Council, as you have set out in your pay policy. Obviously, if you're going to make a different kind of offer, then you've got to take in the list that the answer might be no.
It should be difficult to ask somebody to step up to an ad hoc rate. Tony, can you give us some guidance on what the list will be?
Yeah, Chair, again, hopefully I'll be able to answer some of the questions that have been asked. So the Chief Executive range is quite a wide range here, and there's a whole variety of that in the country and Northwest. Our range is set out in the pay policy as 158 to 178, and there's a range of incremental points in between. Committee will probably need to know that we do have a strategic director who's on a level below, and those great tax overlap. So our senior director, who's the director of children's services, that grade runs from 145 to 161. So in managing that person, then obviously there's an issue around the chief executive's grade and making sure that it's appropriate in that scenario. Janette asked around kind of how we compare. Again, there's a lot of different arrangements in place, and our range in some ways, quite a wide range, complicates that. So if you look at the Liverpool City region, the average starting is around 159k and the average soccer range is 166. But that does exclude Liverpool and above that, which is an outlier at 201k. Met authorities in the northwest, the average is around 179 and the average top is over 186. But I would stress that not all have ranges, so sometimes, like for example, those is just a one salary. And that's something when we bring the report back later on in the year that, of course, in terms of the appropriate bands that we apply to this post. So there's some kind of information there, and our intention would be to bring back quite a comprehensive set of data for the committee to consider when we look at going out to parent and recruit, as well as some of these other issues that have been picked up around paid service and some of the issues we've discussed tonight.
This is just a point of clarification, Chair.
It's a clarification, not a speech.
Yeah. So my understanding is I tried to get this multiple put into the pay policy at the last meeting, but it was conversation wasn't it? So Phil's understanding of what was it, I don't think it's there at the moment, is it? Is that right?
That's right, we have a ratio about the, there's a number of ratios in the pay policy, sorry to you Chair, which about the lowest pay to the highest pay to exact the average salary. So at the moment there's still the case, Councillor Green asked that the ENA committee for a review of that, and it's been a little bit overtaken by events because this happening. But when we bring the paper back, as I say, around our options for going forward with the chief executive pay role, pay terms and some of the other issues, then we can revisit that discussion or have that discussion about the level of pay that we feel is appropriate for the role.
That's quite interesting and does clarify a number of things, to be fair. But I think you're right so much. I mean we do need to bring forward a review of the senior structure of the salary options. Or the chief executive in the year, sorry.
Does that not sheen?
Along with salary options for the chief executive to a meeting committee and say in September. But you know, we do, just like you did last night, the standards, you need to consider it properly and look at all the ins and outs of the facts, and what direction you want the organisation to go. And you know, just like the standards last night, that's going to take place over a period of time, isn't it? So I think to act on the hoof and to come up with figures, whatever they may be now, I really do think it's a bit irresponsible at this stage. Particularly, I think, in light of it's important that we have somebody lead the organisation at this time. We've got the Ofsted, haven't we? Coming in now. We've got the local plan, have we not? Yeah. And we've got a number of big new generation projects going out, particularly the Wirral Global Company. So we do need somebody leading from the floor. And I do think it is a premature, just to back around big now, can't stop doing anything now. We need to review and look at it properly over that period of time, back to September, with facts and figures and an analysis. Tony's give us a little bit of ear size, which you want. That's my opinion.
If I could just mention that we do seem to have been chewing on this for about an hour now. I've got Pat next, then Jenny, then Johnny. Well, that was Pat. Then Jenny, then Johnny.
There's an assumption here that Paul Sator is the best person. I don't know who he is at all yet. But for a role paying over £160,000, I would expect us to go to market for that. For if you're looking at a year or 6 or 12 months interim role, that's a serious role, and I think we should go to market to get the best possible interim individual to cover us as chief executive interim for us here. There may also be from that, from go to market, an excellent external person with phenomenal expertise who is better than anyone internally that we have currently in Wirral Council. And that individual may need to be able to take up and step up later on to maybe be able to get the best permanent individual. So for me, a 12-month appointment, paying that sort of money, would warrant a going to market role, just assuming that the person internally is the best person for the role.
Mike next.
Yeah, there's two things. One is that we are talking about an interim role, and those who take an interim role shouldn't expect the actual full wages of the present person, because they've been taken on that, the present person should be taken on that role. This is to have extra duties for, let's say, the person who's going to be appointed, they're going to get extra duties. And this takes me back to the comment that you made. The returning officer does not have to be a senior officer. The returning officer does not have to be a senior person. It can be an officer of the council according to section 35(1) of the Representation of the People's Act 1983. So that actually can be taken, that role can be taken away from any future person in charge of the council, whether it be head of service or the chief exec. And we have very capable officers within the council that can do that and have been proved in the past to be more available than the actual returning officer. So that's number one. Number two, we need to be looking at what we're going to pay 8 persons as an interim role, not as a permanent role, because we need to go back to council last fall, a decision on, we're going to go with a recommendation hopefully of what we want to have in the future, but there are a lot of things that can be happening. So I don't think we should be looking at paying a chief exec figure of 170 plus for someone in that role, especially if the work we spread out going to item four, we need to understand the pressure off the appointed person. So really, I suppose in a way that should have come before this, because then we would have said some of the work we spread out. We've got a senior leadership team that should take on they should take on some of the role between them all anyway. So I think really we can spread the work out without actually adding to the senior leadership team. So that's what I would say.
Okay, Mike, but that would put us in a wholly different situation. Janette?
Why?
Sorry,
no, I thought later on. Sorry, yeah. Sorry, it was just a point of clarification. I think mentioned the salary being 170 plus, but the salary range is 158 to 178, and the proposal would be that all of his course at all would be on the bottom, the first stage of that, that range.
Well, now, who else would like to jump into the pond?
Jim, can I just say, the thought of going out for an interim to the market is going to take just as long as getting a new chief exec. So I really, we need somebody to step up to the plate now. And I feel that if we've got somebody who actually knows the work of the council, who's been working so closely anyway with Eric, at least we'd have some stability, because as we see in item four, we've got that vacancy as well. And I just think it needs a seamless sort of take over at the top by the chief executive and force it all from there, I think would be ideal in that position.
Just a comment, Chair, that the meeting seems to be veering towards going out to market for a local. If that's the intention, then you need advice on
we've got some of these moves
So, Chair, the recommendation before you is a discussion that the Council has an existing evaluated pay scale for a Chief Executive, which is marginally above what the senior directors are being paid. So that's the discussion of your potential offer to one of those senior directors. I'm merely pointing out that if the proposal is to make a counter offer, or actually to make a different offer to one of your senior directors, you carry the risk that they will say no, and therefore you ought to be having a discussion over what happens if they say no, which they're quite entitled to do, and that would be, well, what does the alternative mean in terms of going to the interim market?
Sorry, Anita?
Personally, I've heard what everybody said, and I think I'd like to move the recommendation as outlined, recommendation two.
I'll second that.
Okay, well, we now have a proposition before us.
And we have one very similar, just
sorry, Leslie, I couldn't press my
button. Sorry, I'm just saying that we have one with just a couple of subtle differences that we want to move.
Okay, well, there is a proposition before us.
So,
perhaps there's an amendment.
Yeah.
Is there an amendment?
Then I would suggest that.
Let's be absolutely clear, though, so everyone understands. The proposition is that we do run with the proposition before us, the written proposition.
So, Chair, then, so there is the proposal is as per the recommendation, and what you're about to hear is an amendment of that proposition.
I would like to put forward that we recommend to Council Mr. Paul Sartor be appointed to the post of Chief Executive Health Aid Service at the moment, to include the appointment as returning officer and electoral registration for a period of 12 months. And it is just 12 months, not only to, without the, until the time's permanent appointment is made, for a period of 12 months. That appointment being on an interim basis, subject to a successful quarterly performance appraisal, and as a salary which we believe, clearly, you've
Really, you thought you'd get it all down? No. Paul, did you get it?
Chairman, I think I got it somewhere, which is, so three changes from the proposal as an amendment. The first is to delete or until such time as permanent appointment is made. Although, of course, that might be shorter than 12
months.
Secondly, that's subject to quarterly performance review.
Satisfactory.
Sorry.
Yes, successful
performance review. And then lastly, that a comment is recorded that no officer should be paid more than 5 minutes.
Indeed.
So that's the amendment, Chair, is the second.
Seconded.
Then, Chair, it's a vote on the amendment first, and then make the position of this. So firstly,
please show those in favour of the amendment. That's four.
Is it four?
Yeah. Four. Those against? Six. The amendment is lost.
So, Chair, that takes you back to the main proposal, which is as per recommendation.
Those in favour of the main proposal?
Yeah, I mean, I think in order, if there's someone can do it as chief executive, we tend to make it unanimous.
I believe that's unanimous.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair.
Well, thank you all for your patience and particularly your
brevity. We've got to do the motion,
Chair. We move on to recommendation three, Chair.
That's given this can be controlled. Bill was the first one to hand up.
Yeah. We want to add something that gives some teeth to the job, which might be what was suggested to us. And I'd like to add to number three, the report must include the results of a full exploration of how the differential in salaries between the chief executive, between the permanent chief executive and other corporate directors, deputy directors and other directors can be reduced.
Would it be possible to widen that?
Because
I think it's beyond simply differentials being reduced. In my opinion, I've already stated my view, I mean, that no chief officer should get more than the Prime Minister, but also I'm quite attracted by a chief officer and the limit between what the moderately paid lowest member of excluding apprentices, lowest paid member of our staff, and the multiplier to what the highest paid member of our staff. And I raised that last employment appointments. And could we add into your point about differentials, that point about coming up with a fixed multiplier between the, I'll leave it to you, but I'm thinking of the lower average paid member of staff to the very highest member of staff.
So hold on, Jeff, I'm not quite clear here. Are you amending the amendment, or are you trying to put something else in? Are you trying to cobble two different ideas?
I think it's the same point. I'll leave it to Phil whether he agrees.
I'm making a friendly amendment.
Yes,
it reminds us of the point he raised previously at early meetings, and I would accept it.
Okay, so you've accepted Jeff's proposed...
And what's more to the point, make sure our colleagues know what it is.
I would like professional officers to give us some comments on how that would be implemented.
explore and find out the horizon scanning, what happens elsewhere, and now you put the restriction in, and I disagree with it. I think we should have, include the full exploration, totally agree with that, but not that we look at reducing salaries.
Okay, do we need to debate this, or should we go to vote? Okay, those in favour of Councillor Phil, the opposition. My casting vote is against. I'm not going to say has that disposed of item 3?
No, Chair, because the, that was voted down.
That was only a vote, so
the floor is now open for further.
Did you take on what you wanted or not, Anita?
So, Chair, that my recommendation was that we do take recommendation 3 as it stands, but include a full exploration needs to take place.
Okay, that's a
good question. Can I just be clear? So Anita, you'll forgive me, but I'm not quite clear. I'm trying to get to my own mind what that amendment means in terms of what we're asking.
Go on, Anita, say it slowly.
So I'm saying the recommendation straight as it states that we have that the report containing considerations and requisite steps for the permanent appointment of the position head of paid service be brought to the committee by the Director of Change and Organisation Design at a convening date which includes a full exploration of looking at the horizon scanning of the market.
So well, excluding the reduction of, so does that
I didn't mention it.
Well, you did in your earlier comments about what you were
going to say. No, Jeff, that was perfectly clear. All she meant to do, something that Anita was saying, is that she was against that principle, but she's actually proposing something that doesn't include it.
I'm not saying that it would be excluded. It should be part of, but not. Jeff, if you listen to me, please. What I'm saying is that I don't think we should have that as a marker to say that that's what our intent is. But if it so happens that that's the situation, then that will be presented in the report before us.
So just again, so I'm clear through you, Chair, that what you have moved still is wide enough to include what Phil has said.
Is that right?
Chair, may I assist?
Please do.
Possibly. Because I didn't quite understand what was meant by full exploration. So, wording used in the report was consideration of the role, remuneration, process, and appointment. So, if that is including a full exploration of the role, the remuneration package, and the process for appointment, would that be enough to satisfy?
Yes, but what I am saying is that I don't think we should add in that the aim is to reduce salaries. I think what we should, we'll get the report back based on that information.
So as a proposition, is maybe just said what we should do.
Yes, please.
The proposition is before.
Is there a second?
Now we can debate the amendment. With a proposition,
well, I'd like to suggest an amendment, Chair, which would add some more evidence that the report should pay full regard to concerns expressed regarding multiplier expressed by members. See, as a
second?
I second that.
So, it's a vote on the amendment, Chair.
Those in favour of the amendment, please show. Those against? Five. My casting vote is against.
So that takes you back, Chair, to
the substantive.
The substantive motion.
It was as amended.
Yeah. So it is the clarification. It is as per recommendation three, the added words that is to include a full exploration of the bond remuneration process and the points.
Those in favour, please show.
It is my intention to look at that.
feel?
I think so. I think he was saying he's going to cancel his own job, so he's got nowhere to go back to. Is that right?
Okay. Can we go to a vote?
Yeah, through the chair.
Mike, just
what is the timescale on this?
I think realistically, I think we'll probably look at September or October before there is a report to come back to you about any recommendations for the future, but obviously subject to approval of this recommendation, we want to go with an instrument appointment immediately.
So, have you got someone in mind for that instrument
appointment? It would be an internal.
An internal? Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay, I would ready to go for a vote on that. Just let me sign up with your chair. If this committee wish to form.